Conversations That Matter is a partner program for the Center for Dialogue at Simon Fraser University. The production of this program is made possible thanks to the support of the following and viewers like you.
Welcome.
Glad to be here.
The Salish Sea Marine Survival Project. What exactly is that? Maybe let's just start by defining what the Salish Sea is, and then let's talk about marine survival, because really it's a big international program that you've got underway.
It is international, and it is bigger than we've had in the past. I mean, there probably are bigger, because there are global programs beyond it, but this is without doubt the largest single science program specifically directed at understanding the dynamics of Pacific salmon. And in Canada, it's in the Strait of Georgia. But the Salish Sea is Puget Sound, Juan de Fuca, and of course there's the US and Canadian side, and then really the Straits of Georgia up to about Campbell River and over to Butte Inlet. And that's the geographic range of what we're doing. And of course, it's impossible to separate Johnson Strait from the top of the Strait of Georgia. So we continue into that, and we work with another group that's doing some of that research up there. The program is science-based, and what I emphasize about the difference is that, put really simply, it's doing everything all at once, and it's the first time we've really tried to do it on that scale. And the reason for this is there's hundreds and hundreds of publications in the Salish Sea about salmon, but a particular area, a particular interest, a particular set of years. There's never been a program where everything is integrated at once, and we do it for a very, very intense short period of time. So we are looking at all the components of the ecosystem that affect salmon, and we're doing them simultaneously.
So as you explain that, I think about the magnitude of what you're talking about, and I can understand why it's never been done before. The depth and breadth of the work that has to take place must be extraordinary.
It's one of the beauties of being an independent, not-for-profit group. I come from a science background in the federal government. I knew there was expertise that was not being integrated into this program. So it was a matter of seeing if we get a commitment to find the money to use the benefits we have already. We already have labs, we have people, we have ships, and they weren't all being utilized in this way. So all we've really done, working with Long Live the Kings on the Puget Sound side,
That's your American counterpart.
That's the American counterpart.
Yeah.
So the Pacific Salmon Foundation basically had the idea, we had the vision, we put the program together with a science team that I composed, and then we went out and had to raise the money so that we could empower those people to do what they really do well. I mean, we have excellent researchers, but they weren't really being focused into this question. And the thing that really surprised me when I looked at it in detail, it's the first time we've ever actually looked at the whole system up to salmon. Everybody looks at different elements. But salmon is so important to the Pacific Salmon Foundation, to BC, to Canada, that it amazed me that we really couldn't find any comparable program.
So salmon are important from a very commercial perspective, sports fishing, the commercial fishery, and so on.
Yeah.
But what's their role in the cycle of life within the Salish Sea?
You know, the Salish Sea, it's probably not a major component of the marine ecosystem because they're a user of that system. But to BC and to the people around the Strait of Georgia, well, 75% of the population of BC lives around the Salish Sea. And of course, we have Victoria and we have Vancouver, but we have the entire Fraser complex. And all the people that come out here for recreation, for retirement living, and around the Straits of Georgia. So it really is important. And the reach of the salmon is that they spawn in freshwater, they use the local coastal waters to survive and grow, and then they go out to the Pacific, they bring all those nutrients back, and they really are the drivers of a lot of our freshwater ecosystems. So it touches a huge variety of important topics in BC, not the least of which is the cultural history for all our First Nations.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So for thousands of years, Pacific salmon has been the staple. And a lot of anthropologists suggest that the stability of the food for First Nations is why they've been so creative, and they can stay localized and they have secure food so they can work in other elements of the culture.
Well, it's extraordinary when you look at the migratory routes of returning salmon, or yeah, those who are leaving to go to sea and those who come back, how far into the province they travel, and
right,
the communities that they touch along the way. It's a diverse and expansive system.
Well, we talk about the long in within to the province. So you're going up. The longest one is the top of the Fraser, about 1,800 kilometers.
1,800 kilometers.
Yeah, but the biggest, of course, is the Yukon. The Yukon Chinook go 3,200 kilometers. So, yeah, salmon are an incredible beast. I mean, we may never know everything about them and that, but they stimulate a lot of interest.
But the Salish Sea Marine Survival Project isn't just about saying, oh, wow, what an amazing species salmon are.
Yeah.
It's really about what's happening to them. Chinook and coho, what has happened?
Well, what has happened and why hasn't anybody done anything about it?
Well, you can't see them. That's the problem.
Well, maybe. But, I mean, you can see the money that they're generated. So it's difficult to understand why people didn't see the effect and feel the effect more and do something about it. So what I'm talking about is that in the mid-1990s, the recreational fishery for BC, which is worth about $1 billion a year.
Just the recreational?
Just the recreational, right? I mean, to be honest, the commercial is at a low ebb right now. The recreational is very influential in BC. But that fishery has changed. It used to be the heart of the fisheries in the Strait of Georgia, right? So when we talk about losing production from Chinook and coho salmon, what we really lost was 90% of the catch, and we lost about $750 million a year to local communities.
In the Strait of Georgia?
In the Strait of Georgia. That's how big the fishery was, right? And so that's what I mean. So it crashed in 2 years. That's 20 years ago.
So what happened? What are the numbers that we're talking about, the numbers of fish that have gone missing?
Well, I mean, when people were out fishing coho salmon, which is probably the biggest set of numbers, you were catching over 1 million coho a year in the Strait of Georgia. And if you talk to people that fished at that time, they could catch coho year-round. Of course, they went from small bluebacks in the spring to the bigger fish in the fall. You had Chinook salmon that stayed in the Strait year-round. So that's a big change. Now they don't do that very often. And then you've got the other species. And the most graphic example is the Fraser sockeye salmon. So in 2009, we had the lowest return in 100 years, and it triggered the famous or infamous now, the Cohen Commission.
Mm-hmm.
Right? What happened in 2010? That was 100-year high, right? The total opposite in 1 year. And then when you ask, okay, well, what could possibly cause that? The best reasoning is it was right in the Strait of Georgia. The winter 2006, the biggest event in Vancouver was the damage to Stanley Park. We had a terrible year of winds, very high, right? Did a lot of mixing, and then we had a terrible spring. We had cloud cover right into May. We had rain constantly. So if there's cloud cover, there's no sun. There's no sun, there's no phytoplankton, no phytoplankton, no zooplankton. And so it's a domino game, right? But it starts every year with our weather, right? So the weather didn't instantly change in those 2 years. So the story is bigger, but we don't really understand it yet. So that's what we're really challenging people to do is come up with some reasoning on what do we have to monitor so that we can manage salmon better and produce more of them.
I got to get you to hang on for just 1 second while we take a quick commercial break. We'll be right back.
Conversations That Matter is a not-for-profit program made possible thanks to the charitable support of the following and from viewers like you. Please visit conversationsthatmatter.tv and help us to continue to produce this program.
So you talk about 06, 07 there, but then you said that 20 years ago we saw this dramatic drop.
1994, 95.
Do we know what happened?
Surprisingly, when we go back through the records, of course, we have a lot of airports around the Strait of Georgia as well. Airports have all sorts of weather data, all right? So we have lots and lots of information to look at. And there is no single effect that you can see that would generate this except the change in winds. And winds, where we used to get really, really cold outflow winds and the Squamish winds, they call them, and so on, we're getting a lot more winds that are the opposite direction. And so it could be that it's all part of an early sort of sign of climate change, because you're getting a change in the big climatic cells over the oceans. The most recent one is 2015 blob that everybody talked about, right? So up the west coast of the United States, you had that very poisonous type of algal bloom and that. But in the Gulf of Alaska, you had this massive body of warm water. I didn't honestly know what to tell people what that was going to really do. It had huge effects. We had effects from Central Oregon right through the Bering Sea in salmon.
Because they would enter into that area.
They were in that area, and it was so unusual for them.
And they couldn't survive.
Well, they survived.
Or there was a high mortality rate?
There was a higher mortality rate. We saw returns of probably about a third of what we expected. But the big effect were things like the fish were small enough that they were going right through gill nets that you use for management. We weren't even getting the right signal in terms of the numbers coming back in the fishery, which is something we had never seen before. So, you know, we say that salmon are important to us, but we really have to look at their future right now.
It's my understanding that there are quite an array of factors that have gone into disrupting the habitat from salmon. Quite some time ago, there was a big push on around spawning grounds or beds, and the effect that logging, in particular clear cut logging, would have in those areas. Have we addressed that now?
You know, pretty well, and it's a really good point because the points of interest have changed through time. So when you're talking about the impact of forestry, that was really the 1970s. Mm-hmm. You know, and then we went into the 80s and we had the protests on the West Coast. So forest
and we had the Forest Practice Code, right? Yeah,
Practice Code. So there have been significant changes and improvements there. Yes, there's still some abuses, but it's much, much better than it used to be. The problem is you can't fix a forest problem in a short period of time. That's an 80-year fix. Mm-hmm. By the time you get those trees growing and stabilizing the environment and stabilizing the stream banks and all the rest. That's improved substantially, but where a lot of the development and concern now is water use, mm-hmm. right? So salmon need water, that's pretty simple. But now we have the province's Water Sustainability Act passed about a year ago. One of our major projects as a foundation is gonna be making sure that's implemented. That's key. But then you've got a lot of the other development, and of course we have all sorts of debates about development in BC. The big one to us is how are we managing our estuaries and the lower portions of the rivers? Mm-hmm. That transition zone, so there's a freshwater fish, the juvenile salmon, going out to sea, and they completely reverse their physiology. They go from pure freshwater to pure saltwater, and they do it in the nearshore estuary zones. So we've applied some technologies called acoustic tagging. So we put small tags in fish, and we can track where they're going and how long they're staying in certain areas. Mm-hmm. So sockeye salmon coming down, their critical zone is the Fraser Estuary up to about the center of the Strait of Georgia.
Okay.
And they spend probably 3 to 4 weeks in that area before they start migrating out. Well, we never knew that. We thought they just went through the strait.
Oh, you didn't realize that they were basically
staying in specific regions of the strait.
Now, it's my understanding that they rely heavily on the eelgrass and the different seaweed beds and whatnot along that area, one for shelter from predators, but also two because that's a source of food. What's happening to those natural hiding places and food sources?
Yeah, they've been degraded quite extensively through the strait. The eelgrass is a place to start. We have a lot of communities that are doing eelgrass restoration, mm-hmm. but that's because they can see visually that there has been a lot of degradation of that environment. And it is critical because that's in the near shore, right? And so the juveniles that come out, they will stay along the margins of the shore and use the eelgrass for habitat. And it's for both avoiding predators and it's abundant food for them. And so they grow very quickly once they get into the marine. But the other one that is very common and I think is an interesting story is kelp. Mm-hmm. And it goes hand in hand with the recreational fishery because when I'm not a Western guy, so I came out from the East, and people always used to tell me about raking for herring. I'm going, what? Right, because they went to the kelp beds where the herring juveniles were, and they literally could use big rake type things, and they would collect herring, they'd use them for live bait. Well, because those people use that, they noticed that a lot of these kelp beds are gone. The kelp is not as productive as it used to be here. Mm-hmm. And there's an interesting story with the green urchins and so on at the bottom, and they graze kelp and that. But the real effect was that they lost a lot of the kelp beds in the similar sort of time period.
And so, just from over-harvesting?
Well, it might have been over-harvesting, but there had to be some environmental change as well. And one of the things that they're very sensitive to is silt. They're an annual plant. Their spores fall to the bottom. And they're sticky, and they will adhere to the bottom, it's rocks, big cliff walls and so on. And the problem is if there's a lot of silt, then the spores can't attach. And so it might be as simple
like
as
slides
that.
Away. It's like ice to them.
Yeah. Yep, they can't get hold and so they just simply die. But interestingly, we've been working with some community groups and now we can grow kelp forests. So we literally will do the sort of reproductive collection of the spores, and they do this in an aquarium, and that, and then you can go out and you actually can plant them, and you use cotton string in that. And so the spores go on that, and you can lay them out, and the kelp grows very well. What we haven't figured out yet is how to get them to revegetate each year. So we're still working on that part.
This is our second of three breaks. Yeah. We'll be back in a moment.
Conversations That Matter is a not-for-profit program made possible thanks to the charitable support of the following and from viewers like you. Please visit conversationsthatmatter.tv and help us to continue to produce this program.
Are we seeing increased acidification of the waters here, and what effect is that having on salmon, specifically to our conversation? But there are 3,000 other species in the Salish Sea.
Yeah, no, unfortunately, we already have acidification in the Strait of Georgia. And that, to me, is startling, because when you think 80% of the water mass in the Strait of Georgia comes in through Juan de Fuca. That's a massive amount of water coming in on an annual basis. And yet we're being able to measure acidification already. Now, it's not that extensive, right? So locally, I think you were talking about pH as this measure of about 8.3. I think we're down to about 7.9 to 8. But that little bit of change alone is causing die-off in oyster spat that commercial users or growers will try to put out. You're seeing effects on other shellfish. The big fear is there are some zooplankton that contribute food to salmon that may be affected for the same reason, because the chemical reaction is that they can't build their shells.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I mean, it's a long time known relationship in terms of acidification and carbon and seawater, but we never thought we'd get to the extent of measuring it this quickly. So as we get changes in climate, what if you have a really early, like 2015, the first year of our program, we've actually established it as one of the earliest spring blooms we've seen for years and years. I think there was only one year earlier than that, and it was going back quite a ways, right? Well, was that good or bad? Because it may mean that you had the bloom, but you didn't have the right sort of small zooplankton at the right time to harvest the bloom. Right? So if you miss that first bloom and you miss the first sort of development of the zooplankton, you could go from something that you think would be really good to something that was really not good at all. And it's called match mismatch.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So it's all a matter of timing and sequencing and how it works.
And so if it mismatches, then the food supply isn't there for the juveniles when they exit the river system.
Right. But they have alternatives, like we mentioned herring.
Yep.
Right? So the herring is going to come back on an annual basis. And that, and if the timing is such that they missed a lot of the early zooplankton, some of the fish will be able to feed on small herring. But small herring, even as larval fishes, they're bigger than the zooplankton they're small fish feed on. And so you could have a year that's really, really good for Chinook.
Yeah.
Right? But it could be really bad for pink salmon.
Okay. So. Spawning beds, the estuaries, the phytoplankton, the zooplankton. What about predators like seals? The seal population has gone up.
Lots of stories about predators. Our best story in the Salish Sea so far is, first off, I have to emphasize that when we think we're losing salmon is in what we call the early marine period. So we're talking 6 to 12 weeks after they enter the sea. Right, so this includes when they get into the estuary and then they start using the near shore habitats. And if you'd asked any salmon biologist before, they would have said, well, fish predators are the obvious cause.
Mm-hmm.
So we've spent quite a bit of time gill netting for the obvious fish predator. So far, we haven't found any known fish predator with a stomach in its, with a salmon in its stomach. And that, so, I mean, we keep saying, well, you're not fishing in the right place.
Yeah.
Right, so, but we've convinced ourselves there's not as many fish predators making this difference as we thought. So, yeah, coming back to seals, and the big one that I think we really are struggling to estimate are birds. I mean, when you think about it, where are the birds? A lot of them are around the estuaries. We're on a flyway for millions and millions of birds coming through the Strait of Georgia.
Right.
Right. So these birds are all eating something. They're going through here because there's no food.
Final break, and when we come back, get to hear where we're going with the research that you're developing. We'll be right back.
Conversations That Matter is a not-for-profit program made possible thanks to the charitable support of the following and from viewers like you. Please visit conversationsthatmatter.tv and help us to continue to produce this program.
I have to go back to what I said much earlier, which is it's the magnitude of it all. Like, as you explain more to me, I think, okay, maybe we're starting to understand these things.
Yeah.
How do we influence change? Like, how do we, and do it in a way that makes the helping hand of man beneficial, not make it worse?
Yeah, that is sort of the perfect circle because, I mean, my background has been involved in salmon management and science since about mid-1970s. And the most common thing that delays a decision is a lack of information, because people can say anything they want. There's no way you can contest it. It's one person's opinion to another person's opinion, and that very seldom leads to a significant policy change.
How long do you think it's going to take for you to be able to come forward with this body of research data that says, okay, here's what we know.
On the farms that we're talking about only?
Well, no, I'm talking about the whole thing. Because, as you pointed out, it's interconnected. It's a complex system, and you can't just isolate one element and say, well, there, that's it. We'll fix that, and it'll all be done. So how long before you think that we'll be able to have a mass of information that will put us in a position where we can make informed decisions?
Well, at the end of 2017, that'll be our 3 years of intensive research, and then we have a year and a half pretty much to sort of pull together what we're going to say from it. Will we answer all the questions well enough to change policy or change management? In some cases we will, in others I don't think so. So one of the things that we've been doing is looking at, well, okay, we've made this massive investment as a foundation and donors, I mean, but $10 million from just one foundation to direct this work. All right, so what's the legacy of that? Where do we go with that in the future? And so we've been working with the UBC in terms of what is that university? They're the obvious sort of primary center people think about as academics in BC. So they have developed something that they're going to call the Institute for Oceans and Fisheries.
Mm-hmm.
And we hope that this will be the legacy, that we will be able to direct some work there and that they'll continue to really follow the key questions. But I think we'll be able to make some significant inputs to how to improve things for salmon after our five-year program, 2018.
Well,
specific questions we'll answer along the way.
Yeah.
Right. So the disease question I was talking about, we're going into a very intensive analytical component right now for 6 months, and we should really see some interesting insights within this year.
Well, I applaud you for what you've done, because nobody was doing it before you created this focus, and let's hope that we're not too late and that the results in the long run will be beneficial to not only us, but most importantly to the salmon themselves.
That's true.
Thank you very much for doing this.
It's my pleasure. Yeah.